is Ray Charles. And I'm Michael Bormine. I'm a doctor of medicine and a science fiction writer. I'm going to tell a story today. And it's a love story. And it comes from my lifelong love of the body and everything connected to it. Everything about the body is amazing, astonishing, of course, with the brain and everything else, from cells to the systems that make our body work, to the organs that make our body work, and to the molecules. Every bit tells a story. And the story today is going to start, I'm going to describe some of the building blocks of human life. And then I'm going to talk about a disease that originated in Africa and became a political football. I'm going to talk a little bit about racism in medicine. And then I'm going to end up looking ahead a little bit. The story I'm going to tell today is a factual story. But it might as well be fiction, because it has all the elements of fiction. There's adventure in it, there's discovery, there's, to me, excitement and suspense. There's tragedy, but also hope for the future. And being the body, it could really start anywhere. But today, it's going to start here. This is an electron micrograph of Plasmodium falciparum, which is the agent that causes malaria. I'll say a few words about malaria in a minute. First, I want to talk about this. This is one of four falciparums. This causes the worst kind of malaria. And it's part of a much larger group called protozoa, the first animal life on Earth, protozoa. And many protozoa are parasitic to us and cause disease in us, but not all of them do. Some of them live in us harmlessly along with our microbiome. Now, probably you've all heard about our microbiome. It's a very hot, sexy topic these days, deservedly so. Our microbiomes are all the bacteria, the viruses, the fungi, and other organisms that live in us but are not us. Last count, there were about 40 trillion cells in our microbiome compared to about 30 trillion human cells. And our microbiome lives in our gut, it lives on our skin, it lives in our throat, in our nose, in our tears. And I think of it as a kind of envelope, a little coating inside and out. And as we move through the world, it moves with us. Or depending on your perspective, you could say that we move with it. By numbers alone, it outnumbers us. But regardless of your perspective, the truth is, the fact is, that when we talk about being human, we're only partly human. We're at least half other than human. And that's why we like aliens so much. This is another protozoa. This one does cause illness in humans. This is called Trichomonas vaginalis. It causes vaginal infections, and the way you make the diagnosis is you take some fluid, you put it on a slide, look at it under a microscope, and if you see something move, that's the diagnosis. These things wiggle around like jitterbugs, and what makes them wiggle are those things on the end called flagella, that are tails. They're their tails. Life didn't always move on Earth. Life first appeared about 3.5 billion years ago. For the first billion years, there was no motion. And then, 2.5 billion years ago, a remarkable meeting took place. Two molecules met and fell in love. One we call actin is kind of long, and tubular, sort of hollow, semi-rigid. The other, which we call now myosin, fit right inside the center of this tube. Myosin attached to the walls and then would detach And when it detached it, it could move one way or the other. And when it moved up, that whole structure shortened. And when it moved down, that whole structure lengthened. Now myosin means muscle, and actin means motion. And actomyosin is what our muscles are full of, and it's what we think of as motion. And actomyosin brought us motion. When our muscles contract, they're shortening. When they relax, they're lengthening. Same thing happens when we swallow. That's a muscle motion. When our heart beats, even inside our cells, we have actomyosin. Actomyosin helps our cells divide, helps the chromosomes line up. It's everywhere. Even plants have actomyosin. It helps push them up against gravity. I'm going to take that off. Before 2.5 billion years ago, before those two molecules got together, motion depended on chance, random events like wind or rain or ocean currents. This was the beginning. Now motion could be purposeful, so that creatures could move towards something they wanted, like food or a mate, or they could move away from something, like a predator. And over time, this freedom of motion evolved, this independence, and took on other forms. So that now, when we think of freedom of motion, we think of the freedom to move away from danger, like a war, a famine. Freedom to move towards something, like another city, for a job, or a relationship, or another country. Freedom of motion is kind of heart and soul, the bedrock of freedom of choice. That's how I think of it. And it all started 2.5 billion years ago. This is a photograph of human sperm, and those long tails, they're all about motion. That's why they exist. And I show this slide really so that I can show this one, which I cut out decades ago and I've kept because I love it so much. That's a photograph of a human sperm joined to an egg. And obviously it's not always everyone's choice. Sometimes it happens accidentally. But when it is your choice and when it happens, that's a very beautiful thing. Now, as it turns out, this is not a human egg. This is a hamster egg. And it's actually used in tests. It's one of the tests that are used for people who are having difficulty conceiving a child. And if the egg doesn't slap the sperm away, or if the sperm doesn't veer away, but they actually join, then that's good news. To me, it's remarkable that a human sperm and a hamster egg would join. The astonishing thing to me is they were that close, that they were that compatible. Of course, nothing would come of the union. We wouldn't keep dividing, except we might. These days. We might, because, you know, we're playing with genes all the time. We're cutting and splicing. So it could be soon we're going to have this. Or this. Even more frightening. We already have this. Here's the malaria parasite again, an electron. It's not that big, believe me. It's hardly visible by the naked eye. But it moves kind of like an inchworm. And it's carried by mosquitoes. And mosquitoes, when they bite us, going for our blood, it swims into our bloodstream and it heads right to the liver. And it goes into the liver cells and there it incubates, divides, and then it bursts out by the thousands and floods the bloodstream where it causes disease and does all its dirty work. Malaria is a worldwide disease. About 1 billion people are at risk for it. About 300 million people have it. About 1 to 2 million people die from it every year. And the people who don't die are severely affected with fevers and chills and body aches, lassitude, weakness. It's really awful. They're also affected by anemia. And the reason they're affected by anemia, that after the malaria parasite goes to the liver and busts out, its next target are the red blood cells, where it goes through a second incubation period and then busts out of the red blood cells, destroying them in the process. And its real target is what the red blood cells carry, is the pay dirt, which is hemoglobin. Now, hemoglobin is the last piece of biology I'm going to burden you with, but it's a beautiful, beautiful molecule, so I'm going to say a word about that. It's probably as old as actinomycin, 2.5 billion years ago. Its ancestor was a key part of the great oxygenation event that changed the face of life on Earth, brought oxygen into the atmosphere. Since it's evolved, and in humans, hemoglobin's purpose is to carry oxygen. It picks up oxygen in the lungs, carries it to the tissues, where it slowly releases it. We have two kinds of hemoglobin. We have hemoglobin when we're in utero, which is fetal hemoglobin, and then when we're born, we quickly develop adult hemoglobin, hemoglobin A. This is another color picture of the malaria parasite around the red blood cells. This is what happens after it gets inside, incubates, and busts out, and destroys them. This is a picture of hemoglobin. And it's really a beautiful molecule, symmetrical, folded, four units, about 600 amino acids long. Amino acids are the building blocks of protein. And at the center of each unit is an iron molecule, which is what gives our blood its characteristic color and its taste. And attached to the iron is oxygen. It's fun to look at like this, but a two-dimensional slide doesn't really do it justice because it exists in three dimensions. And in three dimensions, it's very different than the linear, long linear actinomycin. It's broad, spherical, globular. Each of these units are globe-shaped, hence the name hemoglobin. And it actually exists in four dimensions because as it moves through the body and gives up oxygen, it suddenly changes shape. So that's four dimensions, but now factor in what happens if you don't have enough hemoglobin, or if you have the wrong hemoglobin. How it feels to be starved for oxygen, unable to breathe. And then how it feels if you get oxygen when you're feeling that way, or if you're given a blood transfusion. The dimensions just keep adding up. So I think of hemoglobin as a doorway. And to me, anything in the body is a doorway. Or a wormhole, I guess, if you prefer. And you know where wormholes lead you to, all sorts of dimensions. Hemoglobin is protein, and proteins are coded for by genes. The gene for hemoglobin is about 1,600 base pairs long. Our whole genome is 3 billion base pairs long. And every time a cell divides all those bases, the whole genome is reproduced extraordinarily. But mistakes are made, and virtually every mistake is corrected. 99.99999% of the mistakes are corrected. It's amazing, our ability to self-regulate and correct mistakes. And even when one mistake might get through, chances are it's not going to have an effect, because most mistakes in the genome are silent ones. This is all very good, because we want our genome to be stable. We don't want it to be fluttering around, but every so often a mistake is made that doesn't get fixed. And sometime 10, 20, 100,000 years ago, a mistake was made that wasn't fixed. One base pair out of 3 billion got switched, and that was in the hemoglobin gene. And because of that, one amino acid in the hemoglobin molecule got switched. And because of that, hemoglobin acted differently. Now, instead of maintaining its big, fluffy form when it, as it traveled through the blood, giving up oxygen, now when it gave up oxygen, it clumped up, condensed. This is a photograph of a normal red blood cell. Now, that's just about the most beautiful thing. It's like a donut. And these are really squishy and flexible, and they can get through the tiniest opening you can imagine. Here's a photograph of that, of a red blood cell that has the sickle mutation. Here's another photograph. And here's another. Now that could have been called hemoglobin luna, you know, lunar like. But they called it hemoglobin sickle because it looks like a sickle. And that that sickle cell hemoglobin. So when that happened, a funny thing happened to malaria. Malaria loves hemoglobin A, feasts on hemoglobin A. It does not like hemoglobin C. And the people who had hemoglobin C did much better. There's 60% less mortality for people who carried hemoglobin C. So what happened then? Well, you know what happened. We had a random mutation on one hand, and we had a survival advantage on the other. Evolution happened. And Darwin didn't even know about it. And that mutation spread, and the sickle cell carrier strain spread. And it spread all over where malaria was at the time, which was sub-Saharan Africa, Middle East, and India. So now we're going to jump ahead thousands and thousands of years to the 16th, 17th, 18th, and 19th century. That's the age of the big sailing ships and intercontinental exploration and discovery and trade in goods, trade in humans. And Africans were captured and enslaved, transported across the Pacific to South America, North America. And when they came, they carried the sickle cell trait with them, many of them who had it. And malaria existed in North America, in the what became the United States at the time. And it also was brought in also by all this trade and these settlers. Malaria existed as far north as Maryland and all the way down to Florida, all the way to the Gulf and up to Ohio. And in some areas of the deep south, it was endemic. And the people with the trait did proportionally better than the people without it. But it was a big problem, and the government over the years mounted efforts to get rid of malaria, and finally in the 1950s, that was a long time, they eradicated malaria more or less from the United States. So now there was a situation that people who had sickle cell trait no longer had an advantage. But they didn't have a disadvantage. People with sickle cell carriers, what they're called, are pretty much normal. They're really healthy. Most people don't even know they have it unless they get a blood test. Very, very extreme conditions, like going up in a rocket ship, you might notice it, but for the most part, you never do. That's not what happens if a sickle cell carrier and another sickle cell carrier decide to have children together. And when that happens, the laws of inheritance apply, as elucidated by one of my heroes, Gregor Mendel, who was a brilliant botanist and mathematician and a monk. And he figured us all out growing pea plants in his garden. And this is how, in simple terms, the laws of inheritance work. On the top are two carriers of sickle cell. So being a carrier means half of your genes are hemoglobin A, half of your hemoglobin genes. You have two, everyone has two hemoglobin genes. One, most of us, we have two A's. If you're a carrier, one is A and one is S. So two carriers get together and decide they want to have children together. For the purposes of statistics, they have four children, but it works the same, of course. One of the children are going to get a hemoglobin A gene and another hemoglobin A gene. So they're going to have two hemoglobin A, and they're going to be unaffected. One's going to get an A from one parent and an S from another. Same with another. They're going to get an S from one and an A from another. They're going to be unaffected as well. And one child is going to get an S from one and an S from another. And they're going to have the full-blown sickle cell disease. And that is not a good disease to have. That is an awful disease. And I want to say a word about that. In this country, there are about 100,000 people with sickle cell disease. Most are African American, not all. About 1,000 births per year, millions worldwide. And the life expectancy is reduced if you have sickle cell disease. In sub-Saharan Africa, it's like an 80% mortality rate before 2 years old, much more. Not that way here, we have treatments here. But the suffering is enormous. Virtually every organ is affected. You get liver failure, spleen failure, bone death, heart attacks, lung disease, strokes, terrible anemia, which causes other problems. But a hallmark of the disease, really the hallmark, is pain. Some people with sickle cell disease have pain every day of their life. Many have sporadic pain. And nearly everyone, let's say, with sickle disease have what are called sickle cell crises, which happen one, two, three times a year, which last anywhere from a day to 3 or 4 days and are indescribable. They're just all, I've read accounts, I don't have it, so I can't tell you, but it's agonizing and awful. Now, I'm taking a breath, and I'm going to tell you that one of the most exciting things about being a writer is when something surprising happens. When you're writing a character, and the character does or says something unexpected, and all of a sudden you're off in a whole new direction. That happened with this talk I'm giving you today, because the talk started as a talk about how exciting to me what I do in medicine and the body is and the underpinnings of the body. And I'm using sickle cell as sort of a template and an example of this wonderful thing we call evolution and how adaptable and acrobatic the body is. And as I started thinking about it and reading about it, reading more and doing research and reading accounts of people with sickle cell disease and what they've done to try to find it, what they've gone through, I started thinking about pain. And I started thinking about their pain and pain I've personally had and pain I've treated as a doctor, which is a huge part of being. And so my talk took a left turn, a really good left turn. So I'm going to talk a little bit about pain. And we've all had pain. We all share that experience. If you're African American in this country, you've had a different experience with pain. African Americans are systematically underdiagnosed and undertreated for pain. Millions of studies show this. There's a racial bias among doctors, pharmacists, nurses, in the treatment of pain. And that's fed by misconception and prejudice. And it's also fed by the nature of pain, which lends itself to bias. I'll speak for a moment about that. There's so many kinds of pain, so many shades of pain, so many perceptions, theories, beliefs. So many ways to alleviate pain, so many triggers for pain. Nearly every creature on earth experiences pain. We need pain to survive. It's what tells us that we're under assault or attack, hot, cold, sharp, and internally, it's what tells us there's something wrong to go for help. In those conditions and illnesses like diabetes, leprosy, drug overdose, where people aren't experiencing pain properly. Maybe they don't have it, they can't experience it at all. Infections, injuries occur, and injuries can lead to infection and loss of limb, sometimes loss of life. We really need pain. Pain is one of the four cardinal signs of illness. I learned this as a medical student. The four ors: tumor, rubor, calor, and dolor. Tumor, swelling, rubor, redness, calor, fever, heat. those three stand together because they're objective. They can be measured. And scientists love to measure things. And I like to, well, I don't like to, but I like to measure. Dolor, pain, is really different. Dolor is subjective. It's self-described, self-defined. It depends on communication, and that depends on two things. It depends on the person experiencing the pain being willing and able to describe that experience. And it also depends on the person hearing about it to be willing and able to hear it, to listen. And that depends on trust and good communication. When there's stereotyping and prejudice and preconceptions and prejudgment, that doesn't happen very well. Different people experience similar pains in different ways. Different cultures have different experience and perceptions of pain. One noted author went so far as to say that culture, not science, defines the meaning of pain. And culture is really important. When I see a patient, really, I can't imagine not asking who they are, where they come from, what tribe they belong to, if it's not obvious. Because that tells me something, and if I don't want it, or I'll ask directly what their perceptions are, what their expectations are. But culture isn't the only thing. Science obviously has something to offer. Anatomically, for example, we know that we sense pain all over our body. We have free nerve endings, cover our body, concentrated in our most sensitive areas, fingertips, lips, face. And these nerve endings run by these long nerve fibers to our spinal cord. And some of the long ones, you know, in our legs, that's why when you stub your toe, it takes a while. That's why you can squeeze it really fast to try not to feel the pain, because it takes so long for it to get to our brain. But eventually they do. They come to the spinal cord, they're bundled, and they go up to our old primitive brain, the thalamus. And from the thalamus, they go to our highly evolved cortex, the thinking part, where we're conscious. And a funny thing happens if you sever that connection. If you cut the fibers right above the thalamus, a person will know their pain, they'll experience the pain, but they won't be bothered. So that's why, well, in the 1950s, prefrontal lobotomies did just that. Now we think of that as barbaric, and was truly barbaric. I'll also submit to you, we won't discuss it, it was also humane for some people, because there were people who were ready to kill themselves when they were hurting so much. Anyway. Thank God it didn't go on too long. It did fall out of favor. But it advanced our thinking about pain, and it allowed us to distinguish between pain and suffering. Surgery can detach the two. Other people have found ways to do it with less extreme measures. And those people will teach us, that will tell us, happily, that there's a difference between surgery, between suffering and pain, that pain is inevitable, suffering is optional. Good luck with that. Sometimes that works. I never had a person with a lobotomy, a patient, but I did once have a patient who had really bad diabetes. He was really bad pain. And then he got a little stroke, something that happens with uncontrolled diabetics. And it was a very little stroke. It was so little that it just happened in this one part of his thalamus, and it knocked out his pain sensation. It was amazing. It was a miracle. And he was so happy, and I was so happy. But no one's ever been able to reproduce that. It's bad. Although not for want of trying. These days we're using all sorts of things, deep brain implants and probes that they don't work so well at this point. But anything, and over my 40 years of practice, I've tried everything to treat pain. I'm open to everything. And the list is very long. Physical therapies, cognitive reconditioning, psychological treatments, anything is fair game. And of course, medication, and I printed out a list of all the medications for pain. And I was going to read it, but I don't have enough time. Missing from the list, but not to be neglected, are narcotics. And you really can't talk about pain without talking about narcotics. Narcotics are wonder drugs. Opium is nature's blessing, or gift, or benediction to us. They're regulated by the FDA, which started out as a wing of the Department of Agriculture, and now belongs to Health and Human Services. They're policed by the DEA, which is an arm of the Department of Justice. And over the course of their long history in this country, they've been a source of contention and comfort, and warnings, and testimonials, and debate. So back in the 1800s, you could get them without a prescription. Here's something from Bayer, the makers of aspirin. You could get heroin hydrochloride down at your drugstore. And here's one I really like. The cough syrup has alcohol, cannabis, chloroform, and morphine. Wow, that is going to work, I promise you.
Skillfully.
But this was, and here's one that was really, really popular at the time. Mrs. Winslow's soothing syrup. Can you see it for children's teething? And it was really, really, really popular. Can you see the date up there, 1887? Decades. It was really popular. And it really worked. It contained morphine. You didn't have to say that, it wasn't on the label. And people loved it, and infants did really well, and then infants also died. And as the deaths mounted, that led to a kind of effort to sort of restrict the roots, and actually restrict the use, or at least for some truthfulness in labeling. And then in 1911, the Supreme Court ruled, what do you think they ruled? They ruled, no, you don't have to label. They sided with them, with the manufacturers. They said, no, you don't have to put what's in it. You don't have to tell anybody. The next year, 1912, this is astonishing. What I can only imagine was a bipartisan Congress overruled the Supreme Court and said, you guys got to put labels on what's in this stuff. So that was a step forward.